Well, good morning, everyone. Look at this sea of smiling faces. I'm assuming you're smiling. I'm just assuming. I can see it in your eyes now, though. That makes me happy. Well, church family, it is so wonderful to be back in the house of the Lord and to see each and every one of you. As we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, I want to begin with just some news of the church, and I'm saddened to share with you that our dear sister in Christ, Helen Allen, has passed. She passed yesterday morning. We will have some sort of memorial. We're still working out the details on that one, working with George, and so I'll have more information for you as more information is made known. But I do want to share her passing with you and let you know, as you recall, you know, George and Helen were part of this church for many, many, many years, and had even recently been accepted into the membership again. They decided to come back and make this their home, and they had gone through the new members course even before all this pandemic stuff started, and we didn't really have an opportunity to have a meeting and formalize things. So as far as I'm concerned, they've been members for a very long time. Whether it's on paper or just simply part of this family in our hearts, they are dear to us, and so we do mourn her loss and just be with George and during this time. So I'll have more information as it comes up, but would you join me as we go to the Lord, asking him to bless our time here as we prepare our hearts. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning for this gathering of saints, this gathering of believers, and we pray, Lord, that you have prepared us for what you are going to do here today. Today is an outpouring of your mercy and grace. It's a testimony to your work, even in the midst of a difficult time. And Lord, we thank you for the fact that you don't stop working. Lord, you have been at work through this whole pandemic, and when the world seemed to stop, Lord, you just continue to move on. You are bigger than any sickness or illness we can have, and Lord, we thank you for the blessing of each and every person in this room. We thank you for the blessing of the believers that you have gathered together, and in that same vein, Lord, we thank you for the blessing of Helen. Lord, we thank you for the impact that she made in so many lives during the course of her life and the blessing that she was to this church family. And Lord, we mourn with George and the family during this time, and we ask that you would heal the wounds that are here in this room, but Lord, that you would equip us to walk alongside the family during this difficult time, that we may come together, Lord, and united in you during this time of healing and restoration. But Lord, we have gathered here to lift you up, to seek your face, to see you exalted. And as we have gathered for that purpose, we pray that you would incline our hearts to you. Lord, give us songs of praise on our lips, even though we can't sing them here at this time. Lord, they are surely on our hearts. Lord, we pray that you would call to our minds every blessing that we have received. May our hearts be overflowing with gratitude for you. And Lord, we ask all of these things, praying in the way that you have taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
O sovereign God, O matchless King, the saints adore, the angels sing, and fall before the throne of grace. To you belongs the highest praise. These sufferings, this passing tide, under your wings I will abide. And every enemy shall flee. You are my hope and victory. victory. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, clothed in power and in grace, the name above all other names. To the valley for my soul, thy great descent has made me
So I hope you brought a snack. Today is going to be a little bit of a potentially longer service. We came back to one service, but we booked the band for two, so we're just going to go a little longer now. No, today is a special day in the life of this church. Today is Scout Sunday, and so we are blessed to have some representatives here of our Scout troop that meets here. For those that do not know, we have a Scout troop that meets here at the church, Troop 71, and we've been blessed to have them here for many years, and in fact, they are an integral part of this church family, and we are blessed to have them. And so we're going to give them an opportunity to sort of share what's been going on during all of this time. You know, we weren't able to have this kind of service last year, so it has been 2 years now since we've heard from the Scouts, and they've continued to do things. Of course, they had, I'm sure, breaks and difficulties just as we have during the earlier parts, but they're still gathering together and doing great things. And so, Gary, would you come up and share with us for just a little bit here what you guys have been up to?
Good morning, and we certainly missed not doing Scout Sunday last year. It was the sort of the beginning of when the whole impact of the pandemic was striking our community. At any rate, thank you for inviting us in your church. Of course, thank you for supporting Troop 71. Just a couple things. Before the shutdown last March, the troop competed in a scouting, large scouting event near Mount Rainier, Klondike Derby, which is an annual event, and Troop 71 took first and second place. So that was very impressive. The other, you know, we've been meeting remotely with Zoom meetings. We did have an award ceremony where we met out in the parking lot. We did do three trips one which included kayaking from the ferry over to Ketron Island. We are building a camp over on Ketron Island. We have a landowner who has been supporting the troop for almost a decade, allowing us to camp on his property. And now we're in the beginning to build a camp over on the island. I've been your scoutmaster for several years, and my son became an Eagle, and I'm surrounded by a great scouting community. I would like to introduce one of my assistant scoutmasters, Eric Thornburg. Eric, could you stand up, please? Also, John Applett, could you stand up, please? John is on the committee, the troop committee, and he takes care of all our equipment. And incidentally, John built two of the dog sled that we used to win first and second place at the Klondike Derby. So he's a great craftsman. Anyway, I would like to introduce our senior patrol leader, Owen Thornburg. Owen, could you describe what your role is in the troop? And Owen, I think you were going to introduce somebody. Okay. And now Gabe, come on, is going to come up, and he is going to talk about and do a slide presentation for everyone.
Okay. Today, this slide is about everything we've done. Today we will be talking about how Troop 71 has been doing over this year. First, we started, the first slide is right here, and it's introducing our troop regularly. Scoutmaster Mary Burton, Senior Patrol Leader and Assistant Patrol Leader. Presented by me, the troop historian. High Adventure. May 2017, Troop 71 hikes at Mount Rainier and spreads the night at two locations. Location one was Panarum Point, elevation 6,830. Location two was Camp Muir, for the older scouts, elevation 10,188. The day was clear and beautiful. Night brought 40 mile per hour winds and almost blew us off the mountain. But we still had a great time. We learned a lot about ourselves on that trip. And these are some pictures. The 2020 game campout. Let the games begin. A scout is clean. Time to go home after playing all night. A Klondike Derby 2020. A Klondike Derby is an annual event held by some Boy Scouts of America and Canadian Scouts districts during the winter months and is based on the heritage of the Klondike Gold Rush. BSA units have been running Klondike Derby since 1949. This was our last official camping event when COVID-19 hit. The events vary by district, but the typical Klondike Derby consists of several stations where patrols or units must test their scout craft skills and their leadership abilities, earning points toward a total score. The final event is a sweat race. We worked very hard to accumulate enough points from the skill stations and sled race to win the overall championship trophy. New and improved sleds in the works. The finished product. Snow camping. Fun in the snow. Skills competition. Preparing for the big race. Race to the trophy. And the winner is Troop 71. Victorious. Team Troop 71. Swim qualifications. This is us actually swimming the 2020 summer camp, Camp COVID. Working on merit badges. Leather working merit badge. Classroom time. Time for a swim break. Camp COVID graduates. Troop 71's dream, our own camp. Building a new world, Ketron Island. Kayak or ferry over to the island. The troops have landed. Our dream begins. Taking shape. 2020 Court of Honor. Receiving new merit badges and ranks. ...2020 Annual Food Drive. The Heart of the Food Bank. Mission accomplished. Christmas tree lot building the lot. Happy customers. Annual tree recycling with the city. Troop 71 would like to extend our thanks to the Still Community Church, Pastor Owen, and his congregation for all their support and love. The end.
Excellent job. And Troop, thank you guys so much for coming out and sharing and the blessing of what you've been doing. You guys have been pretty busy. you know, I've considered from time to time, you know, maybe going on a trip or something with you. And then I saw that mountain picture, and it looks better in pictures, I think. you know, I've got to tell you, when I started preparing for today, I realized that we were going to be a little abbreviated in time, and so I didn't think I was going to have time to jump into where we were in Acts. And so I wanted to step out and just sort of say, you know, where can we go with this? You know, what do we know about the Scouts? And I've shared before that, you know, scouting was not a part of my life growing up. This is something that's very new to me, and I've been completely overwhelmed in the interactions that I've had with just all the possibilities that come with the Scouts. That was something that I think I missed out on in my youth. So I did a little bit of research, and I came across the Scout Oath and Scout Law. This is from the BSA website. And I want to read off what I have for the Scout Law. And correct me if I'm wrong on any of this stuff here, but the Scout Law has 12 points. A Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and get this, reverent. That one jumped out at me. I didn't expect that. Yeah, good job, Dwayne. You got that one. Still got it, sir. Listen to what it says here. Again, this is from the BSA website. Be reverent toward God. Be faithful in your religious duties. Respect the beliefs of others. That jumped out at me. Because I wonder if as Christians, as believers, do we know what it means to be reverent? A scout is reverent. But as a church, do we know what it means to be reverent toward God? Well, the dictionary definition says that reverence is a feeling or showing of deep and solemn respect. Okay, it's not bad. But see, the problem with that is, as happens so often in the English language, we have taken some words and we have sort of oversaturated them to the point of forgetting what they actually mean or minimizing their meaning. And we look at this word respect. We use that for many, many different things. And just for example, even just in that one statement there, you know, the third section there, respect the beliefs of others. Well, in this context, it means to acknowledge their belief and their right to believe that and allow them to be whether or not we affirm or agree. That's what it means to respect another's beliefs. We acknowledge that they have the right to hold to them whether we hold the same views or not. Now, this, of course, refers to faith specifically, but there are other ways that we can respect one another's beliefs, choices, or values and many different areas, regardless of agreement or disagreement. For example, some of you are going to be rooting for the Chiefs tonight. I respect that. Others for the Bucks. I respect that too. And some of you are like me and had to Google up who was even playing so I could make this point. And I affirm you. So, this is not what it means to be reverent toward God. This is not the same attitude that we have when we give God respect. We don't simply acknowledge his existence and just let him be, whether we agree or not. Reverence for God means something so much more. It is more than simply having a deep respect. And so while we've looked at the dictionary definition of reverence, I prefer instead to allow the scriptures to speak for themselves. So what does the Bible say it is to be reverent to God? Now I'm going to give you a little bit of a heads up. I'm going to break one of the rules that we're taught in seminary, and it's one that I don't think I've violated too many times previously, but they jokingly say, you know, don't flex your Greek or anything like that, right? Don't turn it into some academic exercise. But today there's a little bit of importance behind that. We're going to find in total about 6 different words that we all point back in the English to reverence with. But in the original text, these are very different words, each with their own unique meanings and connotations. And for us to understand biblical reverence, we have to look at these. Now, in the Old Testament, we see two words that are commonly translated as reverence. There is, and forgive me if there's anyone out here that knows the correct pronunciation of some of these, and I butcher one of them. Doing my best here. There's the yare, which is the fear of God. Many times throughout Scripture, we see fear and reverence used almost interchangeably. The fear of God, and I'm going to come back to that. You see, we talk about that quite often, the fear of the Lord, the fear of God. Again, I will come back to this, expand on this more, but we often have to remind ourselves that this doesn't mean the quaking in our boots, hiding in the corner, hoping that God doesn't find us kind of fear. It means something very different. Now, there are times in our life in which that may certainly apply, but that means something very different, and I will come back to that. The next word that we find is the Shaha. This is a form of worship. It's an act of worship. It is a falling down or lying prostrate before someone, before the Lord specifically. An act of submission, an act of worship. This too is translated as reverence. In the New Testament, we see some similar things. We see the eidos, which is a modesty. It means to look through downcast eyes as if averting your gaze. Again, humbling oneself. The phobeo is fear. So again, we see the fear of God being echoed in the New Testament that we find in the Old. This is the word that is often used in the passages where we see, do not be afraid. It means submission in the presence of one superior. It's also where we get phobia, for just a little reference there in case that comes up on Jeopardy. Intrepo means to be ashamed or to be shamed. All of these words we find lumped into reverence. But when we look at this, at no point in time in any of these definitions do we find anything that resembles our dictionary definition of having a mere respect. Every single one of these points back to a diminishing of oneself, a lowering of oneself, a humbling of oneself in the presence of God who is greater, of a holy and perfect God. You see, simple respect is not enough for God. He deserves more. He demands more than simple respect, to simply allow him to be. There's an old Phillips Craig and Dean song. This was, I think, Lynn and I were dating at the time. I sang this at a church in Beverly Hills many, many years ago. Old Phillips Craig and Dean song says, "Let my words be few." And I remember this one specifically because in the chorus it repeats several times that I will stand in awe of you. It's referring to the Lord. It says, I will stand in awe of you. Now there's a good sentiment there. We should be in awe of God. But there's something wrong with that. You see, when we make the statement that I will stand in awe of you, let me tell you, when the time comes, no, you won't. There will be no standing upright before the Lord. We will be in awe, but we will fall to our face before a perfect and holy and just God. We will recognize in that moment what we can only fathom now. We will see His perfection. And it will shame us because our imperfection will be made known. Our sinfulness will be made known to us in light of His righteousness. And we will fall to our face in humility and revere Him. Now, I mentioned that I would come back to the fear of God and what that means, to truly fear Him in a biblical sense. And the fear of God is a process. It's one that we are all going through. It's one that we will continually go through. And the end result is that we fear disappointing God. But it begins somewhere else. It begins before we even know Him. There is a fear that our sins will be made known. Even if you do not know God or know His laws, we all have known that we are sinners. We have the understanding of right and wrong that has been built into us by God Himself. His ways are made known even when we try our best to avoid Him. And so we fear that our sinfulness will be made known, that we'll be found out. And then we are exposed to truth. Perhaps we read the scriptures for the first time, or someone shares the message of the gospel for the first time, and the truth and the reality of our sin is made clear. What we only suspected before, we now know in full. And we fear the judgment that we rightly deserve as sinners. But praise God, we serve a merciful and loving God. We serve a gracious God who offers forgiveness for our sins, who gives life when we deserved death, who gives reconciliation when we deserved condemnation. Through His mercy and grace and the atonement of our Lord Jesus Christ, we can receive salvation. We can receive forgiveness for those sins. And then our fear changes a little bit. You see, we still have fear. We no longer fear the wrath and judgment of God, and rightfully so. But because we are human, because we are flawed, we now fear losing that salvation that we have received. Now, we know this is not the case, but this is the fear that we have. We have been given a gift, and as humans, we fear losing it. Every good thing we have in our life, our fear is that we will lose it, that it will be taken away. And we find ourselves living according to God's laws, living in a way not to please God, but to retain our salvation, to retain our blessings, to retain our good favor with the Lord. You see, we find ourselves doing the right things, but for the wrong reasons. We're still looking inwards. We're still looking at us. Out of fear. But then we come to the point of maturity in our faith. The point that I hope that we have arrived at, but from time to time we perhaps slip out of. When we reach the point where we have the full understanding and assurance that God has proven His love to us over and over and over again. He has proven to us that at no point in time will He ever remove that which He has so freely given to us. At no point in time will He ever withhold His forgiveness if we are willing to lay ourselves down and repent of our sins. He has proven Himself over and over and over again. And because we don't always get it in the first time, after a while we finally understand it. And we believe it, and we know it. And our fear is no longer that we will lose this gift. Our fear is now that we will disappoint our God. That we will disappoint Him because of our great love for Him. Our fear now is that we will behave in a way that does not glorify Him. It has nothing to do with us anymore. We know that our sins are covered. We know that our salvation is secure. We know we're still sinners. We know that we are still flawed. But we know beyond the shadow of a doubt that the grace of God covers all. And our fear now is that we might bring shame or dishonor to the name of the Lord by our actions. This is a mature fear of the Lord. But as I said before, it's a process. And it's a process that takes work. It's not something that we just sort of stumble into. It takes intentional work. There's a passage in 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy, Paul's giving quite a few instructions to young Timothy. And he sort of wraps it up in verse 6. He says, "If you put these things before the brothers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, being trained in the words of the faith and of the good doctrine that you have followed." Pay attention to this. "Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come." Paul concludes by saying this. "The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance." You see, Paul puts that little capstone on there and says, "Look, I've said a lot of stuff. pay attention to this one. Write this down. This is important. This is a trustworthy statement and is deserving of full acceptance. So let's go back and look at that. Verse 7 and 8 specifically. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Hold on to that irreverent word. That's going to be important in a second here. Rather, train yourself for godliness. Now, when we look at this, we look at godliness as an active word. We look at it as if we're going to do something, and it makes sense. We're training ourselves for something. When we train for something, we're expecting to do something. We train for a marathon by running and getting used to that and getting up to it. We train ourselves to perform in some way, shape, or form down the road. And so he uses this language here, train yourself for godliness. And that puts us in the mindset that this is an active thing, that this is referring to works or godly living. But this is not what this means. Word here is the Eusebia. That's the last one, I promise. Eusebia is piety. Someone's inner response to the things of God, which shows itself in godly reverence. You see, we find this statement is used in contrast to the put away, have nothing to do with the irreverent, silly myths, but rather train yourself for godliness. Train yourself for reverence. This is something that requires effort. We don't just naturally become reverent. It takes work. Now, I personally really enjoy verse 8. For while bodily training is of some value, I can't say that in military sessions. I get in trouble. Godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. We understand the importance of physical exercise, of physical training. It strengthens us. It equips us for better performance in the things that we are doing. And we understand that without it, we decay. We atrophy. We become weak. It's no mistake that Paul uses the same language referring to our spiritual selves. You see, if we are not actively working towards becoming reverent, we will become weak. We will atrophy. We will decay. It's hard work recognizing who we are sometimes. In this world, we like to make a lot of ourselves. This is a very self-centered, very us-focused culture and society that we live in. And sometimes humility is the weakest muscle we have. But we have to work constantly to understand what it means to revere God, to recognize His authority, to recognize His holiness, His righteousness, and to submit ourselves, going back to these words here, the fear of the Lord, the worship of the Lord, the falling down before the Lord, the modesty before the Lord, as if looking through downcast eyes, and being ashamed of our own sin before the Lord, a right understanding of who we are in the presence of who He is. You know, I find that I mentioned earlier we know the benefits of regular bodily exercise, and please understand I'm not downplaying that one. It is of some value. But this body will one day turn to dust. It is the vessel we're given in the here and now, and we should be good stewards of it. So please don't walk away from this thinking anything but. We should be good stewards of the resources that we're given, but this body will come to an end. This vessel will serve its purpose, and then we step from this temporary life into an eternal one. Find that the hardest part of a push-up is getting back up. Usually like the parts where you just sort of get to lay there. But the hardest part of humility is staying down. So the next time You're doing your personal workout at home, and I know some of you crank out a good 200-300 push-ups a day. I know it. I just know it. When you get to about 299, and you find you're about ready to collapse, and you hit the floor, I want to encourage you just to extend your arms, to lie there prostrate before the Lord, to feel what it means to submit oneself. I don't know if anyone's ever done that, to lay down and extend your arms. You are completely and totally helpless. It is a complete and total submission. You cannot defend yourself in any way, shape, or form. And lie there for just a moment and recognize the righteous and holy God that we serve and be reverent toward God. In keeping with the spirit of reverence, we move today to the Lord's Supper. And I invite you to join us. I want to read, of course, as I always do, from Paul's warning here in 1 Corinthians. As we come to the table, we don't do so out of pride or humility, but out of reverence, recognizing that He is our Savior, that we were sinners in need of a Savior in the first place. I hear some of you beginning, and that's good for those that have never used these before. There's two things to peel back. Peel back your plastic first. It's the clear plastic layer on the top. We'll take of the bread first, and then you can peel back the foil for the cup in just a moment. If you do the foil first, you're in for a bad time. Paul says these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning of verse 27. He says, "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." I read these words every time because of those last words there. Eats and drinks judgment on himself. I take this very seriously. That if we come before the table in an unworthy manner, that we drink and eat judgment upon ourselves. And so we take this time to prepare ourselves before the Lord. What does it mean to be in an unworthy manner? Well, if there is unconfessed sin in your life, this is your opportunity to bring it before the Lord. We've already discussed about He freely gives forgiveness to those that repent. And so you have this opportunity here to bring yourself before the Lord and spiritually prostrate yourself before Him. Defenseless, helpless, laying our sins before Him and allowing Him to forgive us of them. If we have any anger or bitterness between another brother or sister in Christ, we lay that aside as well. We ask God to take that from us. And when we leave this place here today, I'd encourage you to mend that wounded relationship. And that we put ourselves in a right standing with God before we continue. And so to that end, I'm going to give you a couple of moments as Kat begins to play. I want to lead you in a word of prayer, and I'm going to give you, for the duration of this song, the opportunity to pray to the Lord alone, revealing our sins, asking for forgiveness, asking for growth, and exercising reverence in the area that matters. Would you join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we come to You at this time, Lord, submitting ourselves to You. And Lord, each and every one of us have sinned in our own ways and our own rights. And Lord, we come to You asking Your forgiveness that You so freely give over and over and over again. Lord, we don't deserve it, but that's the gift of it. That's the mercy and the grace that You show. Lord, we ask that You would make us whole, that You would make us once again righteous in Your sight, that we may partake of these elements, that we may remember the sacrifice that was so freely made on the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we would do so with all reverence. Lord, work our hearts here at this time. Prepare us to receive You. Prepare us to know You. Prepare us to leave here today full of your Spirit, overflowing with your Spirit, to be a vessel and a testimony in the world around us of you and your goodness. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Again, as Kat plays, would you continue to pray? I had a little difficulty with mine. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Church family, before we conclude here this morning, I just want to share something that this was completely unplanned, but this was a blessing that I just think needs to be revealed. Kat, that was not the song that we had talked about. Thank you. Thank you. Originally, the song that was previously discussed was Give Thanks. It wasn't requested, that was just what she was going to play, was Give Thanks, which would have been absolutely appropriate. But the transition to Be Thou My Vision, not only is it a favorite song of mine, thank you for that as well, but the idea of God changing the way we see ourselves, changing the way we see this world around us, changing the way we see him. And I don't know if this was the intent or not, but in the way that that song was played, that first stanza there had a very somber tone to it. I couldn't help but think that it was God correcting our vision of who we are. Again, not to be diminutive or to speak ill, but to recognize our humbled and lowly state. But then you changed it. And in my mind, I find myself almost imagining us from that prostrate position, raising our eyes and seeing the glory of the Lord, seeing the glory and splendor of heaven. And that is the vision that he gives us as well. You see, reverence is not just simply a continual lowering of ourselves. It is a recognition of his glory in full. Thank you. I truly believe that God placed that on your heart, and thank you for blessing us with that. It's getting me all worked up. We need to go ahead and end here. So. Well, church family, again, it's so great to see so many of you. Scouts, it's so great to have you here today. Thank you so much for doing this. We are blessed to have you as a part of this church and a part of our family. To our viewers at home, thank you for joining us here today. You are just as much in our hearts, no matter where you are, from the comfort of your living room or wherever you may be. You are just as much a part of this family and in our hearts. And to one and all, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Would you join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, again, we ask as we leave here today that you would lead us, that you would be our vision. Show us this world through your eyes. Help us to love them as you love them. And Lord, help us to see your glory in it all. Keep us safe and bring us back here again together in the weeks that lie ahead. And we ask all of these things in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen.